A very good morning to all of you. I hope you enjoyed your previous class and it was informative to you. And in the previous meeting also, we teachers told you to go through the key points. You remembered, I guess. I will be telling you the key points and the main things with each of the stanzas, right? So that you have no difficulty in understanding. For your benefit, I have given the poetry along with its explanation available on the screen so that while listening to me, you can see things as well. Now, let us have a quick recap. What we were reading so far, we're reading The Gift of India by Sarojini Naidu, right? So in the first stanza, we have seen the Mother Earth is asking if she has anything to withhold with her back, because she has given everything, her grains, her wardrobes, her garments, gold, everything. Other than that, she's also asking, is there anything to take from us? Not only this, she has given, she has bestowed all the brave hearts to them. She has sacrificed everything she reared up for so long, and this was very much painful. She has given up the sons of hers, born out of her womb, and served the British cause in the First World War I. In the stanza 2, we have learned, Mother India laments the loss of her beloved children in the alien lands. After the fight got over, it is found that the lives of the children, the lives of the soldiers are scattered here and there in the alien world. As we have seen, whenever the call of duty appears, they just obeyed that and they immediately joined their duties. But after the World War I over, Indian soldiers who fought for the aliens during the First World War I never came back home. Like pearls, the lifeless soldiers lie buried in the graves of alien lands. Some of them sleep very silently in the shores of Persia, while others scattered like broken shells on Egyptian sands. Still, other brave Indian soldiers with pale brows and broken hands lie scattered like flour on the blood-drawn meadows on Flanders, that is Belgium, in and France. It is told that they have shed so much blood that the field itself has become red with the red color of blood. So this we have read so far, and we will be beginning with the third stanza. Let us read out the third stanza first, then we are coming to the explanation. Stanza 3. Can ye measure the grief of the tears I weep, or compass the awe of watch I keep, or pride that thrills through my heart's despair, and hope that comforts the anguish of prayer, and the far sad glorious vision I see of the torn red banners of victory? Let us come to the explanation now. Actually, here the speaker asked rhetorically if the British would be able to measure the internal pain and her regret that she has gone through so far. Here, Mother India rhetorically puts a question forward to them, and she is at terrible pain at the loss of her martyred son. As we can see here, you can see the material available. Nothing can surpass her misfortune. She feels an unbearable ache on losing her sons. There is both a surge of pride as well as despair inside her heart. There is a hope, optimism that brings a solace to her affected soul. There is a hope and optimism. It has a glorious vision for the future when there would be peace and prosperity. So even if she was actually terribly grieved at the loss of her martyred son, she was quite hopeful. She has a bit optimism left in her, because she knows with their lives nothing but the solace will come once. It will give all of us the independence, the dream to live in an independent country will become true very soon. That will take the lives of such innocent soldiers who went there, who obeyed the call of duty, who just lost their lives, who never came back to their mothers. Even if it takes so, we will get freedom once. So we can see the conflicting imageries here. She also hopes that the sacrifices on her heroic sons would not go in vain. The tales of valor would be narrated to the future generations, and they would, they would know about the previous generation. They would, memorize. They would recall the glorious past with much pride in them. She has a vision to torn red banners of victory. The soldiers who are given proper recognition and honor would seem to have served for an unworthy cause and to for nothing. Mother India's hopeful vision is layered with optimism as well as irony, as I said. And without war, because she envisions a world without war, because she is aware of the fact that war can bring nothing but exhaustion, nothing but sacrifice, nothing but destruction. But the brave hearts bestowed their lives. Why? Because they actually sacrificed their everything so that we can have an independent world. And the hope that comforts the anguish of prayer. It is written there in the third line. Or the pride that thrills through my heart's despair, and the pride that Mother Earth takes through my heart's despair. See, this pride and despair, these two words are completely different in its origin. Because this, the thrill here means what? The thrill here means the anxiety, the, the pain, whatever she got. But it also shows the pride which she takes on the victory. Okay. Through my heart's despair, through her utmost painful heart, it causes pride on one hand, and it causes destruction, despair on the other. And the hope that comforts the anguish of prayer, and the hope means with the hope that comforts the anguish of prayer. and the far sad glorious vision I see of the torn red banner of victory. It's written there, the torn red banner of victory. Means people's hearts would fill up with a deep reverence for them. See, had a sad vision of torn red banners of victory. Torn red banners means the banner that will be red with their blood, and it will be torn because it suffered a battlefield. But we will take pride holding the banners. It will cause our victory. It will cause our independence. So it's written, however, the lines also reflect a deep-seated irony as we observe in the dauntless soldiers have received the recognition in the pages of world history. The courageous men have done this duty. However, no one remembers them now. So this is an irony that is uttered on the part of our mother India. She's saying that, yes, whenever their time came, they just did not care for anything. They went off sacrificing their valuable lives without questioning anyone. But if I ask, how many of you remember them? How many of people do remember them? No, everyone has forgotten. And this is the irony. This is the reverence that they received. In the next stanza, let us read first. When the terror and tumult of hate shall cease, when the terror means extra fear and tumult means loud and confused commotion, of hate shall cease and life be refashioned on and wheels of peace, and life will be refashioned, life will be remodeled on anvils of peace. Anvils of peace means what? Anvils actually means here the block of iron, but here it is told about the peaceful wall which will prevail once the whole world. And your love shall offer memorial thanks to our comrades who fought on the dauntless ranks. And your love shall offer memorial thanks. We all should offer our memorial thanks as they have fought so courageously for us. And you honor the deeds of the dauntless ones, remember the blood of my martyred sons. So here she used that. Actually, she wants to pay homage. She actually is requesting all of us to show our sense of reverence to them and honor the deeds of dauntless ones. We should honor the deeds that they have undergone. Remember the blood of my martyred sons. She is asking us to remember the blood that is shed there in the battlefields of her martyred sons. So this is quite an overwhelming poem to understand. Here it shows how much she is in pain, right? So I have given here the explanation. The speaker concludes on a note of assurance. The verses display an ardent desire for the world peace and harmony, obliterating revenge and hatred. As it is written there, you have seen that the life will be refashioned with anvils of peace. So she wants to see the world with harmony, which will not have the scornful feelings of hatred and revenge like that. There would be universal love and brotherhood among all. replacing the negative attributes that prevent the growth and development of every nation. The speaker keeps the faith when she says, "The terror and the tumult of hate shall cease, and life be refashioned on anvils of peace." She expects the multiple sacrifices of the admirably brave soldiers would be remembered by all of us with love and gratitude. The revered soldiers will be immortal forever. People's love will offer memorial thanks to the comrades who fought on dauntless ranks. People will honor the memorable deeds of them. They will remember the blood of the martyred sons of India. This Naidu's poetry uses sympathetic pathos for the hapless victims of war. It also shows the British colonizers who have wittily used the young, dauntless soldiers for fulfilling their own motives. The Indian soldiers are among the first victims to face the horrors of the trenches. These men are undoubtedly heroes for their valorous actions, yet they remain largely unknown and unhonored. Ironically, their deeds have been omitted from the pages of world history. The British, for whom they fought valiantly, neglected them without paying proper homage. The British had promised independence and self-rule of India after war. However, the promise turned out to be a farce. They used them as pawns, and once their motive was over, neglected and disregarded their sacrifices. This was something really dishonest and disloyal to be done on the part of the British people. Even if they actually offered us the solace, the independence, the utmost power to rule our own country, actually it was not there. It was lost as soon as the war was over. And the British people did not, you know, confirm what they committed. It was really hapless on our part. It was really hapless on the part of the soldiers. And they fought for their country and they obeyed the call of duty. They went to different parts of the world, alien world, which land they have no idea about. They fought heroically, valiantly, but the pages of history are now blank because maybe it forget to write the valiant works of theirs, what they have done for us. But whatever, the Mother India, she is urging to all of us so that we should not forget them, because whatever sacrifices are made on their part is really valuable to be remembered with reverence. And she is pleading, literally she is pleading the whole world to do so. And she hopes that one day this terror, hate shall cease, and it is then that life will be remodeled with the newfound peace. Mother India at the end demands only one thing, that the British, when out of love, they will offer thanks and respect to the soldiers who fought valiantly. They should remember the brave soldiers of India who sacrificed their lives. So this is all about the poetry. The main theme is well understood by all of you. You will get such materials available there in your study material section. And the question answers also you will get, because in the meeting you were asking about the materials and question answers. So whatever I have provided, hope that will be helpful to you. Because in this poem, no, there is no, difficult word to decode. There is no, complicated meaning to decipher. But only this poem has been uttered by the poet to make us understand about our previous history, to recognize them, to recognize their fight, to recognize their lives that they have sacrificed, what was the cause and what had happened for everything. We should recall their past, the way they have actually, sacrificed everything. We should recall that with our utmost reverence, because we have nothing to do more for them. We cannot bring them back. We cannot pay homage by doing things. We cannot make the loss that the family of those soldiers have made. But we can only do these things. We can show our homage, we can show our respect, we can show our pride. And whenever their names are taken, whenever their heroic deeds are to be recalled, we should do that from the core of our heart, and we should be proud of our Indian soldiers. Okay, so that is all. I'm not going to tell you much, because this is quite an easy poem to decode. As I said, please go through the poem. Everything is available. Do read. And in the next meeting, if you have any problem, we can discuss in person. And if before that, you can email or you can write in the comment section. I'll be always available, and I'd love to solve all the queries. Okay. So take care of yourself. Do study well. Till then, have a great day ahead, and thank you for being so patient.